فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحوم كالطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them, bless every one of us, grant us goodness in the dunya and in the akhirah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us with the heat and with the microphone. Goodness in the dunya and the akhirah. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, I am just one of you. I am just like you. I wish, I hope that I was sitting somewhere in the middle there to be able to taste the heat that you are tasting right now. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive my shortcomings and yours, and to grant us Jannat al-Firdaus, to bless us with love within the hearts. I see faces I know and faces I don't know, but all of them have beautiful smiles on their faces, and if they don't, they have one now, mashallah. So I think it's important for us to realize that the biggest piece of advice we can give each other is something known as taqwallahi, the consciousness of Allah. Every one of us needs to be conscious of his or her maker. We came from somewhere, we are somewhere right now, and we are going back to where we came from, inshallah. We will go back to Allah. And we need never to lose focus from that particular reality. So where you are right now, trust me, you are actually going back to where you were and back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what is meant by back to where you were, meaning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't lose focus, and inshallah we should be preparing for this. This evening I've chosen to render to you, inshallah, some beautiful lessons that Allah says are for those with sound intellect. If you think you're sharp and you think you're intelligent and you think you're very clever, then you need to know that Allah says if you are very clever, if you are intelligent, then there are certain lessons you need to derive from certain things that Allah has made mention of. So if you were to take the Quran, Ulul al-Bab. Ulul al-Bab is in the Quran referring to those with a sound mind. Lub, you know, the brain. So if you have a top brain, Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبَرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. He makes mention of the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, the stories of the other prophets, and he says thereafter, indeed, in these stories, in their stories, there are lessons for those with the sound mind, those with sound intellect. So what are these lessons? I want to take a moment, inshallah, to go through some of them, starting from the beginning, Adam alayhi salatu wassalam. You and I know that Allah makes mention of his story and certain details, and Allah leaves out some details because perhaps we don't need to know them. You know, you might have some details of the stories of the previous prophets within the scriptures of the people of the book, but you need to know that if Allah did not make mention of it, then there are two things that are of importance. Either it is something that the Quran and the Sunnah contradict, in which case we know it is false. Something that the Quran and Sunnah does not contradict, in which case we know that we neither need it nor do we say it's a lie. Perhaps it's a detail, it could be true, maybe it may not be. But it's a detail we don't actually definitely need. In the Arabic term we say, لا نصدق ولا نكذب. We neither say it is the truth nor do we say it's a lie. So if you come to Adam alayhi salatu wassalam, you will find that what's mentioned in the Quran is the accurate version. What's mentioned in the Sahih of the Prophet ﷺ's hadith is the accurate version. And the reason why it is made mention of is for us to know our beginnings And for us to draw lessons from that, you need to know how you came to be. You need to know what happened right at the beginning. You need to know, if I were to do something similar to that, what would happen to me? And this is why I decided to start from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And we're going to draw one or two lessons, inshallah, as we go along this evening. I was given 3 hours to speak, so inshallah I will try my best to stick to the time limit. And I might give you a discount and maybe decrease it by a bit if it gets a bit too hot and sweaty, inshallah. So, we all know that we are human beings. We are all Adami. We are all Adami. You know what Adami means? If you say Adami, it actually means a human being. But it comes from the word Adam. Adam is the first of our species whom Allah had created himself. And the reason why when we say Adami, in the Arabic language, that Ya at the end of Adam, the Yi part of it, refers to the fact that we belong to. So if you come from, for example, Mecca, we would say you are Makki. That means you're connected to Mecca. If you are from Medina, we would say you are Madani, for example. And I'm sure if you are from Melbourne, we would say Melbani, okay? MashaAllah. So, the Ya means you're connected to that particular place. Or the same would apply if it's Adami, you are connected to who? To Adam, alayhi salam. From this I learned something interesting. You see the people seated here, as well as those there at the top, as well as those outside there peeping, and those there right at the back, as well as those right behind who perhaps may not be able to see me direct. We are all Adami. We're all from one source. My great, 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 say that a few 28 times, grandfather is who? Adam alayhi salam. It means I'm related to you. Yeah. No matter what your color is, no matter where you think your ethnicity is from, I'm connected to you, I'm related to you. If I don't feel that, then something is wrong with me. Because somewhere up the ladder, we meet up. And this is why we love each other. This is why we should be caring for each other. This is why the biggest lesson I have to learn from the fact that our root is one is that subhanAllah, we are definitely connected. We are connected. We should be caring for one another. When you see me do something wrong, you don't need to hate on me. You don't need to harm me, attack me, hit me, destroy me, etc. You need to feel for me just like you feel for yourself. You need to want to see me correcting myself just like you would want to see it for yourself. And you need to make sure that you try your best and you keep speaking to me in the best possible way so that you would like the same for yourself if you were wrong as well. Because I'm connected to you, I'm one. We're part of the same species. And you might look at me and say, well, you know, originally I come from this part of the world. Some are from Afghanistan, some are from Pakistan, some are from perhaps Africa somewhere, some are from Turkey, some are from perhaps Europe, Eastern Europe, Western Europe. You know what? All that becomes irrelevant. We are all from Adam and Adam is from Turab. You know what Turab means? He's from the dust. Now, a question I have for you today. Allah has given value to gold. Allah has given value to silver. Allah has given value to various other minerals, like, for example, stones, etc., diamonds. They have value. Why didn't Allah say, I created Adam from gold? I created Adam from silver. I made him from diamonds. But Allah says, I made him from dust. Then Allah says, منها خلقناكم وفيها نعيدكم ومنها نخرجكم تارة أخرى. We created you from it, meaning from dust. And we will make you return into that dust. And we will resurrect you once again from that dust. In order for us to understand that this body we have right now is temporary. That's what it is. It's temporary. When we go into Jannatul Firdaus in the hereafter, into paradise, we will be given a different body, subhanAllah. We will be given that which is absolutely perfect. When you are on the earth, everyone feels, my eye is like this, my nose is like that, I've got a few pimples on my face, perhaps my beard is like this, perhaps my teeth are like this, and this is like that. That's what you feel. Why? We're imperfect. We're not perfect. Everyone has feelings, and by the way, stop feeling that way. You are lovely as you are. You're handsome. You're the dude, by the way. Mashallah. Don't worry, mashallah. You're good looking. No matter what, don't ever feel embarrassed about what you look like, because Allah made you, He fashioned you. And you are definitely gorgeous by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you think you have a little fault, no one has noticed it. Trust me, people don't notice things. Only you notice because you're looking too long in the mirror. Subhanallah. Yes, you're looking too long in the mirror. That's why you start noticing things that no one else has ever, ever noticed. Subhanallah. May Allah make us happy with what He's given us. So Allah is telling us we're going to be one day returning to Him. He will grant us that body which is superbly perfect, and it will be according to our liking. Imagine you are according to your liking. But to do that, you first need to go to Jannah. And to get to Jannah, you need to worship Allah. And to worship Allah, you need to strive. You need to strive. Work hard. Don't do as your whims and fancies dictate. If there is something immoral, something wrong, something in the disobedience of Allah, leave it, cut it out. You will never achieve the pleasure of Allah by doing things that are against His instruction. So we understand that there is a greater plan. Allah did not create us from gold, because then some might say, I'm 22 carat, the other one says, I'm 14 carat, the other one says, I'm 8 carat, someone says, I'm 9 carat, and so on. Allah says, we created you from dust, all of you the same. And we took that dust from different parts of the earth, hence your different colors. And this is why, when we have different colors, Allah tells us why He made those colors. Allah says, so some people are fair in complexion, dark in complexion, some people are, you know, tall and short and so on, all different types of people. Why? Allah says, Ya ayyuha an-nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabail lita'arafu. O people, we have created you from a single male and female, and we have made you multiply into various tribes and people, in order that you may recognize one another. So that I recognize, you recognize me. Why? I'm fashioned slightly differently from everyone else. No one is exactly like me from the beginning to the end. No one. That's the uniqueness of the Creator. It's a sign that there is a supreme maker, because no one's fingerprint is the same across the globe from the beginning to the end. So not just the 6 billion who are on earth right now, but the billions and trillions who've been there from the beginning and who shall be there right to the end. No two iris prints are the same. No two iris prints are the same. Just like when you come from Africa, you know that the zebras out there, no two zebras have the same stripes, and no two giraffe have the same spots. The same applies to the leopards and the other creatures of Allah. هَذَا خَلْقُ اللَّهِ فَأَرُونِي مَاذَا خَلَقَ الَّذِينَ مِن دُونِهِ. This is the creation of Allah. So show me what those besides Allah have created. That's what Allah says. Allah says, this is the creation of Allah. Show me what the others have made. Imagine, my brothers and sisters, if we were all the same in looks, what would happen? What would happen? We would need number plates, mashallah. I would have to call the brother there, like I said before, those of you might have heard me. I said, brother 3, 5, 6, 9, 8, please, 4, please come forward. And once someone would get up from the middle there, and then I'm going to say 3, 9, 6, 4, 8, 5, 6, and then another brother would come. And by the way, the sisters would start with about maybe 6, 5, 8, 8, 3, 3, 5, 9, and then three sisters would get up, and subhanAllah, one of them would come forward and the others would say, I thought I heard you say my number, subhanAllah. In order to actually prevent all of that confusion, do you know what? Allah says, we made you different. Now the problem of man is the devil keeps coming to us and makes us think we are better. I swear by Allah, most of the tribes on earth think that they are better than the other tribes, because that is a disease they are entrapped in without realizing it. Most of the time, ask yourself, where do I come from? And then ask yourself, don't my people train me and teach me that you are better than others? Am I right or wrong? Wallahi, I'm right. You find if you come from one country also, Shaytan comes to you and says, you're from the north, you're better than the people from the south. And if you're from the east, you're better than the people from the west. And those people are crooks, and these people are thugs, and those people are very, they have a temper, and these people have this. No, all this is from shaitan, jahiliya. This is the period, this is ignorance. Wallahi, the problem is we are guilty of this, I swear. We have it in our blood where we think, I am better. You look at yourself, I am better. Why? Allah says, that's not why we made you different, so that you can say, I am better, and this one is worse. Allah says, I made you different so that you can appreciate each other by recognizing each other. I call you brother, come here. I look at you and say, hey, I haven't seen you in a long time. How do I know? Because I know your identity. That's why I can see your face, mashallah. I met a brother here, mashallah. His name was Yusuf. I looked at him and I said, you look just like another brother I know whose name is Omar. Now, have you guys ever heard someone tell you you look like someone else? Have you heard it?
Yes.
And then when you see them and you look at them and you say, what? Nah, it doesn't look like me. This brother looked at a picture and said, yeah, looks like me. Mashallah, looks like me. I started calling you the other name, mashallah, tabarakallah. And that's a true story. It's not a lie, by the way. So, it's amazing how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works. It's in order to recognize one another. That's what I learned from Adam alayhi salam, ulul albab. Allah mentions the beginning for us to understand certain things, not for us to discriminate against one another. But we've become so criminal that if our children want to marry from the culture that has been brought up with us and so on, we say, we can't. Why? You know these people, they're cooks. Astaghfirullah, be careful, be careful. Allahu Akbar, it's your test. The Jahiliya, the period of ignorance, they had the same problem. The Ansar and Muhajirin were very, very different, but they intermarried, subhanAllah. I think a lot of us think we're better than both the Ansar and the Muhajirin, so we won't allow that to happen in our own homes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. إِذَا أَتَاكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوهُ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ عَلِيمٌ. If a proposal comes to you and the level of deen is satisfactory, the level of piety, meaning the level of closeness to Allah perhaps, the level of religiousness, that's one. And the second thing, the character conduct, which includes responsibility, is satisfactory, let it happen. Let it happen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and guide us. It's a point I learned. And you know, we live in cosmopolitan nations like this one. Even where I come from, we have people from different ethnicities and backgrounds, subhanAllah. And you know what? We're meant to be loving one another. We're not meant to be judging one another. We're not meant to be feeling this superiority complex, etc. No, we're all the same. None of us is superior. The Prophet ﷺ says, لا فضل لعربي على أجمي ولا لعجمي على عربي ولا لأبيض على أسود إلا بالتقوى. There is no virtue of a white over a black, or a black over a white, or an Arab over a non-Arab, etc., etc., except who? Piety. Whoever is closer to Allah is closer to Allah, and that is only known by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not by you, not by me. So don't judge each other in that particular way. But let's move further with this beautiful example of Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him from dust. Each one of us should know that, you know what? We're going to return to the dust. And therefore, the best from amongst us are those who will develop the closest link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Adam alayhi salam, shaitan came to him, just like shaitan comes to us. Shaitan came to him, refused to acknowledge his virtue. When Allah says, I want you to acknowledge the virtue of Adam alayhi salam by prostrating to him, and at that time it was permissible, it was a level of acknowledgement of status. Everyone prostrated besides, all the angels prostrated besides Iblis. Iblis refused. He says, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْهُ. I am better than him. This is mentioned in the Quran. Allah says, when Iblis said, I am better than him, that dropped Iblis to the lowest of the low. And what happened? Did it change the status of Adam alayhi salam? No. He remained the same. But Iblis became cursed by Allah because he thought he was better than Adam alayhi salam. A lesson I learned from this story mentioned in the Quran is, when I start thinking I'm better than someone else, then automatically I'm heading in the wrong direction. I'm treading the path of the devil. Yes, If Allah has allowed me to fulfill my salah, someone else has not fulfilled their salah, I can't say, oh Allah, I thank you for granting me the acceptance. I ask you to keep me humble. And I ask you to guide those who are not fulfilling salah to come and fulfill their salah. And I ask you to help me, wherever I am faltering, to help me to come back on the right track. Subhanallah. So there is a concern and there is an active feeling that alhamdulillah, it is the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I spoke about it in Sydney. If you want to check that talk online, it is available on muslimcentral.com, which is one of the largest audio platforms for Islamic lectures, free online. You can actually check that lecture. It's called The Leaking Bucket. And there I showed and proved through the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that there are people who do lots of good deeds, but at the end of the day of Qiyamah, they will lose all of those deeds. So what's the point? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us be humble. Be humble. And when I say humble, I don't mean the followers of Imam Ahmad be humble, but I do mean those who are really humble, mashallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. MashaAllah, Ahmad bin Hanbal rahimahullah was a great imam. He was a great imam as well. And there were a lot of imams. We respect all of them by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters, Adam alayhi salatu was salam, the devil comes to him and tells him, you know what? I need to tell you something. Now Allah warned him. Allah warned him about this devil because the devil said, I'm better than you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, be careful of this devil. He might lead you astray. And I don't want you to eat from this particular tree. Now some people ask that, you know, in Jannah you're allowed to do as you wish. So if Adam alayhi salam was in Jannah, how come he was told not to eat from a tree? That's a good question, right? It's a good question. In Jannah, in paradise, you can do as you wish. How come if Adam alayhi salam was in Jannah, how come he was told not to eat from a tree? Well, that's because the Jannah, according to the Mufassireen, was known as Jannatul Ibtila. It was a special Jannah, a special part of paradise, or a special garden, wherein Allah was testing Adam alayhi salam. No one knew what would happen anyway, because that's his knowledge. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed a prohibition. And this goes to show that when Allah wants to test you, He will test you with fulfilling something and abstaining from something. Not just fulfilling. You don't just eat and eat and eat and keep on eating. There will be certain things Allah says, this thing, don't eat. Now let's see what you do. Subhanallah. You see? Haram, don't eat. What's not yours, don't eat. What's stolen, don't eat. That's Allah's test for you. Otherwise, you can eat. Alhamdulillah, say Bismillah and eat. May Allah grant us good food. Ameen. Wow, that was quite a nice Ameen. See, a little bit. Eat here, subhanAllah. By the way, I found out what these HSPs are. It was something very amazing, and I think I've become addicted in one night. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us in Melbourne and Kate. I pray that the HSPs become tastier and tastier. And I pray that they become cheaper as well. So, we all love food, don't we? MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. But you need to know that what is not permissible, we won't eat, because that's how Allah tests us. Adam alayhi salam, shaitan came to him and told him something to try and lure him into eating. Like sometimes you might see something cheap, and you know what? It's not really halal, but it's so cheap, and you start thinking, come on, this is so cheap. No. We're a mu'mineen, we won't consume it. No matter how cheap it is, even if it's distributed free of charge. We won't, because we know that, you know what, this is not going to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. And by the way, regarding halal food, there is something that I need to share with you. You know, back in South Africa, there are quite a few casinos and nightclubs and so on. So the strange thing is, people say there is one place, there is one place that has gambling and haram and all that, and they have a little place to read salah. They have a little bit of salah on the side. So the people say, because a lot of the patrons there are Muslims. Stop. I hope it's not true, but anyway. I was just picturing, maybe they go in there and make a dua to Allah. Stop. Oh Allah, I'm about to gamble. You know, help me. Stop. That's haram. You cannot do that. You know? the same guys in the clubs, you know, when they go to eat, they say, hey, oh, your samosa's halal here, you know. Mashallah, I see you've got the bottle, you've got everything going, you're gambling, and you're asking me about the samosa, subhanAllah. But anyway, to be honest with you, I would like to think that, you know, it's a sign, inshallah, that perhaps if one thing is right, maybe more things can become right. It doesn't mean that because you're doing one thing wrong, you need to do everything wrong. You're doing one thing wrong and the other's right, there is hope for you. So if he's asking for halal samosas in a nightclub, well, thank Allah that at least he's done one thing wrong and not two things wrong. You see? So that's another way of looking at things. But the point I raise is, shaitan comes to us just like he came to Adam alayhi salam, and he tries to encourage us to do haram by promising us, you'll enjoy it, it's good, sweet, lovely, nice. And then you look at shaitan again, and you look at this haram again, and you look at shaitan again, and you look at haram again, and you make your mind up. May Allah guide us through the lesson of Adam alayhi salam. Shaitan told him, هَلْ أَدُلُّكَ عَلَى شَجَرَةِ الْخُلْدِ وَمُلْكٍ لَا يَبْلَى. Can I show you something if you were to eat from it? Two things would happen to you. Number one, you wouldn't ever die. Never. You live for long. How many of us want to live for long? SubhanAllah. 90, and you still say, I wish I could live for longer. SubhanAllah. 90, come on. You want to clock the century? Not all of us are cricketers. MashaAllah. But SubhanAllah, we all want to live long. It's something, it's nature, it's natural, it's within you. Make dua that Allah takes you away when He's happy with you. Ameen. So, the second thing He says, mulkin, ayabla, you know, property that will never diminish, it will never finish. It's yours, you know, kingdom, ownership, you are owned. These two things everyone's looking for, money and health, right? If I tell you, you become a billionaire if you go to this fortune teller. If you go to this fortune teller, you become a billionaire and he will tell you what's wrong with your health so you can live long. Tempting, not for a moment. No. We're not allowed to go there because we know it's haram. The same thing happened to Adam alayhi salam. He was told by Shaitan, I'm going to show you to do something. If you do it, you're going to have these two things. Long life and lots of wealth. And unfortunately, he kept whispering and trying until Adam alayhi salam and then faltered. They ate from that forbidden tree thinking that it's going to bring them these two things, and it did not. So this is what Shaitan does. Shaitan promises you something, and then when you do the haram, he runs away. SubhanAllah. Reminds me of the guys, when they want to use a girl, they promise her, I'll marry you, I'll do this, I love you, I swear. And I swear I'll marry you. Marry her. What are you saying, I will? Will is future. Marry her now. And what do? They use, abuse, and flick off. By the time they're flicked off, they're nowhere to be seen. Numbers change, city change, everything else, busy with someone else. Exactly like Shaytan, astaghfirullah. Are we little shayateen moving around? I hope not. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make it the case. But my beloved sisters, take heed. Understand that, you know what? Don't fall for people's words. They are lying. Sometimes they might come across so good, but Shaytan also comes across like a fairly pious guy, subhanAllah. He comes across very calm, cool. And you know, he'll reach up and he'll say the sweetest of things. But that's how he trapped Adam alayhi salam, promised him something, did not deliver. Once he got what he wanted, he disappeared. That's what people do. Once they get what they want, they go, disappear. Don't allow that to happen in your life. If you didn't learn this from the story of Adam alayhi salam, you're not a person with sound intellect. Allah says, Ibrah, Ibulil Albab. There are lessons for those with sound mind, sound intellect. Go and look deep into the story. See what you can extract from it. Take it, learn a lesson from it. Apply it in your life, you'll be successful. So Allah says, watch out for the devil. SubhanAllah. So Adam alayhi salatu wa salam fell. When he fell, guess what happened? When I say fell, I don't mean fall as in falling down, but he ate from what he was not supposed to eat from. As soon as he did it, he realized his mistake. And this shows us, my brothers and sisters, we are human beings. That was our forefather, right? He made a fault, he made a blunder. We may make blunders, you know. As soon as you realize it, turn back to Allah. Turn back to Allah. There is no way that you will achieve success if you don't turn back to the Almighty. Adam alayhi salam, what did he say?
رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ
wronged ourselves, and if you don't forgive us, and if you don't have mercy on us, then we will be the ones who are the losers. So have mercy on us and forgive us. And Allah says, we forgave you. What do I learn from this? Allah kept the story in the Quran with so much of importance because I need to learn from it that wherever I go wrong, I need to say, oh Allah, I've wronged myself, forgive me, I turn back to you, I seek your forgiveness, I will not do this again. If you don't forgive me, oh Allah, I'm going to be the loser. I'm the one who's going to lose, not you, subhanAllah. When you sin, who loses? Does Allah lose? No. I lose, you lose when we sin. So turn back to Allah. And guess what? Allah will always forgive you. Always forgive you. Never let shaitan come back to you and make you think that Allah won't forgive you. Never. He will forgive you. He does. And he must. And he shall. And he promised that he will. Today we were watching a little video of a volcanic eruption where the lava was actually going into the sea or the water, the ocean or something. And the brother with me said, you know what? Imagine if this is the heat and the fire and the temperature of the dunya, this molten lava. Imagine what's going to be in the akhirah. And I said, you know what? By Allah's mercy, we will go to Jannah. And I have hope, the mercy of Allah, we will be in Jannah. Say ameen.
Ameen.
We will be in Jannah. Don't you have hope in the mercy of Allah? Don't you know He's the most merciful? Well, try your best and don't ever use the term most forgiving, most merciful to justify your sins. Like some people, you know, they want to commit a sin. So the friend says, no, don't commit the sin. Say, no, don't worry. No, you will anger Allah. No, Allah is forgiving. Don't worry. Allah is forgiving. We can do it. It's fine. We can commit the sin. Don't! Because now you're using something to justify your sin. It's becoming evil. If you did it because of your weakness, because of sometimes your fault, you faulted here and there, it's one thing. But when you defy Allah, it's another thing. It's another thing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still have mercy on us. We're weak, we're man. This is a point that I definitely learned from this beautiful, beautiful, amazing story of Adam alayhi salam. Right at the beginning, I learned that Allah is most forgiving. And Allah will forgive us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors and grant us goodness and ease. I want to push a little bit further to a story of that Allah makes mention of in the Quran as well. Adam alayhi salatu wa salam's children. And this, the lesson I want to draw from this is interesting because it repeats itself even in other places in the Quran with other people, and we might get to that. So Allah says, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ أَبْنَيْ آدَمَ بِالْحَقِّ. Recite to them the story of the two children of Adam with truthfulness, meaning this is the true story. So what was the story? When both of them gave a charity for the sake of Allah, one was accepted and one was not accepted. So one tells the other, I'm going to kill you. Listen carefully, my brothers and sisters, this is a powerful, powerful, interesting point. When did it happen? Right at the beginning of the creation of man. The first generation. One human being became jealous of his brother, another human being, and he said to him, I'm going to kill you. Who taught you this? No one had died yet. Shaitan taught him that this is how you kill your brother. And Allah says, this was definitely a point of regret for the one. Because the two names were Habil and Qabil. In the English language, Abel and Cain. So Cain tells Abel that I'm going to kill you. And Abel says to Cain, you know what? If you are going to stretch your hand to harm me, I'm not going to stretch my hand to harm you. Because I fear Allah, who's the Lord of the worlds. So I'm not going to harm you. From this I learned that when someone does wrong to you, it does not mean that you have to do wrong to them. However, if someone attacks you, you have every right to defend yourself. You know, I can't say, like one brother smacked me, and I say, I'm not going to stretch my hand. Why? Because I read the story of the children of Adam. Well, then the other brother will come and smack you. And then the guy will come and smack you 2-3 times, subhanAllah. And then the fourth guy will come. By that time, you will be all knocked out without even being a boxer, subhanAllah. that's a wrong lesson that you're drawing from there, because it doesn't mean you need to just sit back and let people do as they please. But where there is an issue, you need to think about how to resolve it. Sometimes we have problems. We have problems on a global level. We have problems on a community level, family level, personal level. We have problems, my brothers and sisters. Never do something thinking you're going to solve it, knowing that it's going to create a bigger problem. That is a powerful lesson. Don't ever try to solve a problem by creating a bigger one. Sometimes you have a problem somewhere, and what you do has now made the problem bigger. It hasn't solved anything. So be careful. Shaitan comes to us from all these angles to try and make us dispute with one another so that we can fight with one another. People start threatening each other. We start bullying our friends. We start bullying each other. Honestly, it happens. From a young age, when you're at school and you're growing older, you're taught by the television to do what? To create your little gang, subhanAllah. Even the girls do it. My kids go to a girls' school and I can feel it, subhanAllah. My girls, I can feel it sometimes they have little gangs, small gangs, subhanAllah. And this gang, I don't want to play with you. Why? Not your friend. Not your friend, you're so young. What do you know about friends and girlfriends? SubhanAllah. Too much TV, by the way. And sometimes too many games, subhanAllah. Too many games, too much playing, you know? You don't need to do that. You learn, teach your children to play with everyone. Teach them to be kind to everyone. Teach them to be helpful. Teach them to reach out. Don't teach them to be within their own small cocoons. No. So, at that time, you see the brother says, I'm going to kill you. And at the end of the day, he actually did that. And Allah says, فَأَصْبَحَ مِنَ النَّادِمِينَ. He became from among those who regretted it immediately. He regretted it. But it was too late. You know, today we have people who threaten others. They call you names and then they say, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to harm you. Why? Haven't you learned the lesson? You shouldn't be doing this. Aren't you a person who has learned from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam's story? Have you not learned? And they say, well, Adam alayhi salam was not our Nabi. He was just the first of mankind. Well, why did Allah mention it in the Quran? He tells you in it there is ibrah. There are lessons for those with sound intellect. Learn. You don't cause and create dispute amongst each other. As an ummah, do you know what? We are brothers and sisters. But I want to take it beyond that. Sometimes out of what we think is piety, no, very pious, we start thinking that those who don't belong to the ummah are not our brothers and sisters. Did you hear what I just said? So if I say, no, our brothers who came to see us from the church across the road, astaghfirullah, how can you call them brothers? Are you crazy? You're not a Muslim anymore. Astaghfirullah. It could be our real brothers. How many of us here have family members who are not Muslims? Real brothers and sisters, plenty. And how many of us should realize that even if you don't have immediate blood family members who are not Muslim, but the others are related to you through humankind, through the fact that they are human beings. We are brothers and sisters in humanity. I've given the example in the past of how being kind to a dog has earned a person forgiveness and Jannah. So what about another human being higher than a dog? Definitely. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So we are brothers and sisters in humanity, and at times we are brothers and sisters in the ummah as well. And sometimes, some people, we are brothers and sisters in all three, because we are siblings, or we are closely connected or related, or cousins or anything of that nature. So in essence, we fulfill the rights of all human beings. We fulfill the rights of all human beings. Don't let your piety make you think that no ways, I'm not brothers and sisters with these people. Well, you are. You're fooling yourself. You're fooling yourself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and help us. So, if we don't look at it this way, we will then be destroying ourselves. You know, when you see a person different from you, say, for example, I see someone who hates Islam. What do I do? My aim within me should be, oh Allah, help me to guide this person towards the deen. help me to do things that they would then be able to see the light of Islam, and you guide them to the deen. That's what the Prophet ﷺ did with Abu Jahl. You know who's Abu Jahl? One of the biggest criminals at the time. And the Prophet ﷺ tells him, or says, makes a dua, oh Allah, grant strength to Islam through the acceptance of Islam of one of the two of these enemies, Amr ibn Hisham, who was known as Abu Jahl, or Umar ibn Khattab. And what happened? Just some time later, here comes Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, and he declares the Shahada. Wow! Wow! Why? Because the enemy, the Prophet made the dua for him to say, oh Allah, this is a strong man, he's been harming Islam, he hates the Muslims, he hates me too. You soften his heart and bring him through. How many of us do that? You see an enemy, what are you going to do? You're going to bash his face. That's not the way. That's not the way. Go back to the Prophet's way, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Try and bring them in. Look at Khalid ibn Walid ibn Mughira, radiallahu anhu. What a powerful companion. But prior to that, who was he? He was the leader of the army, of one of the wings of the army on the day of Uhud. And they inflicted so much of damage, not only that, but so many platoons and so much destruction against the Muslims. And the Prophet called his brother, who was already a Muslim, Al-Walid ibn Al-Walid radiallahu anhu, and he says, Aina Khalid? Where is Khalid? He hasn't yet come, he hasn't yet accepted Islam. And you know what the Prophet says? And I love the statement because it teaches me a lot. The Prophet says, مَا مِثْلُ خَالِدٍ يَجْهَلُ الْإِسْلَامِ SubhanAllah. A person with a brain like Khalid cannot be ignorant of the fact that Islam is the correct deen. You follow that? You know what that means? If you have sound intellect and you consider the faith, you will realize Islam is the faith. Islam is the religion. So the Prophet ﷺ says Khalid is so intelligent, he's going to recognize that very soon. And Khalid ibn al-Walid, meantime, while this discussion is going on, he's making his way to Medina Munawwara. SubhanAllah. SubhanAllah. And he was the enemy. If the Prophet ﷺ wanted it, he could have said, oh Allah, destroy this man. He could have said it. Or when he came into Medina to accept Islam, he could have said, your Islam is not accepted, you're a crook, you're a criminal, get lost, or tie him, hang him, and destroy him. He could have said that, but that's not prophetic. So when we have so much hatred in our hearts for our own brothers and sisters, we are far from Allah. We are far from Allah. Remember that. When you are close to Allah, your heart is softened. You become a person filled with love and care, and your du'as become positive. Your supplications become positive. Why? Because you are a religious person. You start looking at the positives. You want to bring people who are far away closer. But when you are close to shaitan, then you want to take people who are close out of the fold of Islam. And you say, this person is not a Muslim, that one's not a Muslim. Why? Because you yourself have a problem with your Islam. That's the reason. May Allah guide us. Remember, my brothers and sisters, don't be deceived by shaitan making you think I'm holy and I'm pious. Because when shaitan says you're holy, he's speaking of holes. And when shaitan says you're pious, he's speaking of the pies. Sometimes the meat pies. Yeah. Shaitan don't mean no holy and piety, subhanAllah. It's actually the opposite. If you're close to Allah, your heart is softened, wallahi. And go and study the surahs of the Quran and the history of the prophets and the story of Rasulullah. You will find thousands of these examples. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظًا قَلْبٍ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. If you were hard-hearted and harsh, no one would have listened to you. They would have run away, dispersed from around you. But Allah says it's the sign of the mercy of Allah that you are lenient. فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. Indeed, it is by the mercy of Allah that you were lenient towards them. This shows you that leniency is a sign of the mercy of Allah. If Allah has mercy on you, He makes you lenient. He makes you lenient. When you want to correct your children, you are lenient. When you want to correct people around you, you are lenient. When you want to speak to people, you are not harsh with your words. People will chase you away. You know, mashallah, today we are sitting here in large numbers. People ask me, how come? I said, you know what? I tell you what, the Prophet ﷺ says, be lenient with people. In fact, when he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhuma to Yemen, he says, Bashira, ala tunafira. He gave them advice. He says, give the people good news. Don't chase them away. We chase people away. Rather, the man came to the, I recall one day in one of our masajid, there was a young boy, never comes to the masjid, and he came to the masjid with his three quarters. You know, we call them Bermudas. What do you call them here? Three quarters. Right? So he came with his three quarters and he had a t-shirt with a sign at the back, you know, some advert, some name, something I can't remember what it was, many years ago. And I was so happy looking at him and I said, MashaAllah, look at this young man. He's come to the masjid, alhamdulillah. And you know what? One of the elderly imams, astaghfirullah, get out! Get right out! How could you come with the shirt? And I said, hey, please leave him alone. No, you don't know he's disrespecting the masjid. Hey, take it easy. Let him come in and read salah. We'll talk to him later. Somehow we can explain to him about this. And the young boy told me, you see, this is the reason why I don't come to the masjid. Why? Look at this, I'm being chased away. I want to tell you, when you are harsh, they will run away. The Quran says that. So this other elderly man told me, and he was okay, reasonable guy, but you see, he's living on an ideal. Sometimes he hasn't been out to see what's going on around in the world. For a young man to come to the masjid, subhanAllah, that is something we need to make him feel comfortable. Welcome, mashallah. You are here, we're not going to doom you, but we will remind you gently again and again and again, and you become a little bit stronger as the doses go. SubhanAllah, you know, you're in grade 1, 2, 3, when you get to grade 7, you're learning a bit more. By the time you get to the varsity, you're learning a lot more, subhanAllah. But you started in grade 1. If you did not know 1 plus 1 right at the beginning, it was okay. You learned it. But later on, you had to know what was 1 multiplied by 1 as well. Because the answer is not 2, it's 1. So my brothers and sisters, it's important for us to realize we don't chase people away. Like I say, when we think we're pious and we look at people and look down at them, subhanAllah, we forget that we have to pray for each other. We have to try with each other. Yes, it's important to be a good Muslim. It's very important to be a good Muslim. It is part of Islam to dress appropriately, to stay away from haram. It's all part of the deen. It's all part and parcel of the deen. We cannot deny that. But when we are helping people to come onto that path, we need to speak to them with respect. We need to acknowledge, you know what? You're trying, mashallah. May Allah make it easy for you, make it easy for me too. Subhanallah. So this we learn from those stories right at the beginning. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. These children, they wanted to fight each other, they fought each other. They became jealous of each other and one killed the other. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for that reason, you know, Allah says this immediately after those verses. He says, for that reason, we have prescribed and revealed to Banu Israel, the children of the Prophet Yaqub alayhi salam, that if you were to save one life, it is equivalent to saving the whole of humanity. And if you were to cause the death of one person unjustly, it is equivalent to having destroyed entire humanity. That's what Allah says. Where is the lesson for us? You take away one life, it's as though you destroyed humanity. You save one life, it's as though you saved humanity. And for your information, Allah didn't say, whoever saves a Muslim has saved humanity. Allah says, whoever saves a human being, a life, the term used is nafs. مَا قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ. On one hand, and the other hand, وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. On one hand, Allah says, if you were to kill a soul, you've killed humanity. And if you were to save a soul, you've saved humanity. SubhanAllah, are you ready to do that? You ready to do that? If someone is struggling, are you ready to help them? If someone is drowning, are you ready to save them? Without looking at who they are, where they come from, what's their background, what's their religion, what's their inclination, etc. Whoever they are, they will be touched by your kindness. Perhaps that deed might bring them closer to Allah. And this is why we say, if Shaitan could convince the children of Adam in the first generation to kill one another, we need to be more careful. Shaitan will come to us in a stronger way. We're further down the ladder to make us want to fight and kill one another. Do not do that under any circumstances. Don't. We're not taught to kill one another. We're taught to build. We were sent to earth to save lives. It's quite clear from the Quran, subhanAllah. And who has control over the lives? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If He wants, He could take people away, and He does. Allah takes the healthy away. SubhanAllah. My brothers and sisters, let's move further. I want to draw an example from the most beautiful story of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, also where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of how right at the beginning, the father who was a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his name was Jacob, Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam. You know what he said? He told his son, "Oh my son, you have had a dream. I don't want you to relate this dream to your brothers because they may become jealous of you." Wow. Have you heard that story? We've heard it. See many people nodding their heads. I want to share with you something interesting. Ya bunayya la taqsus ru'yaka ala ikhwatika fayakidunaka kayda inna ash-shaytana lil-insani aduwwun mubin. Oh my son, don't relate the dream you've had to your brothers because they may become jealous of you, for indeed the devil is an outright, open, clear enemy against you. Which means it was a good dream. He saw a good dream. And Allah tells him, you don't need to tell your brothers. Why? Your brothers are good, but Shaitan is bad. What does Shaitan do? He makes them jealous of you. And if they become jealous, they might plot against you. You know, jealousy is real. Brothers and sisters, what do I learn from this? Can I tell you where I take it? All the way to social media today. SubhanAllah. You eat it? SubhanAllah. I did it yesterday. SubhanAllah. First time. I have a rule. When I'm eating, no photos. I get irritated and upset because everyone thinks, you know, these sheikhs, they come here to eat, eat, eat. That's why the sheikhs are quite big. You know, SubhanAllah. Well, I think there is an exception, and there are many exceptions, mashallah. That's not true. So, when we're eating, no photos. Why? I don't want people to get jealous of what I eat, especially when I come to Melbourne, mashallah. SubhanAllah. So, no photos. You don't need to show the world what you eat. But you know what? Some people have a habit. Yes, it's a different story if you own a restaurant and you're selling food and you want to show people how nice it looks and so on. SubhanAllah, you might want to show people because that's the whole thing. But what you eat, there might be people watching that who don't have food. There might be people who start saying, look how lucky she is. She eats every day. And sometimes that's not exactly what you eat every day. So what we do nowadays, it's become a trend that is very, very worrying. And that is, before we eat, take a picture, put it up. So there's like three times we post during the day. Food, what is it? Breakfast, lunch, supper. So much so that if we missed one, our friends ask us a question, haven't you had lunch yet? SubhanAllah. Haven't you had lunch yet? That's what's happening. SubhanAllah. So my rule is, don't ever put pictures of food up for myself. Yesterday, I decided to put it on my Insta story because you know the HSP was introduced to me and it was just too good, you know. So I said, nah, this is going up. And I heard the story about how it came to about being, and mashallah, we were at a place called, I think it's called Ritz something, down the Ritz Kebab corner or something. And the brother Ibrahim's there was, he's a salesman and a half, mashallah. So alhamdulillah, he made something that was really, really tasty. And guess what happened? I took a picture of me with this thing here. And that's not normal. Look at how I got carried away, subhanAllah. And I posted it on the Insta story, and I knew, I told Brother Karim who was with me, I said, you know what? I can tell you my wife's going to message me just now telling me take it off. And I'm not even 5 minutes past, and I got a message on WhatsApp, remove that now. And I said, okay, I love you more than the food, so I'll take it off. I'm talking about last night. Some of you might have seen that actually. Do you know that? And SubhanAllah, I thought subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. Have you realized one thing about food? The moment you put it in your mouth, it's over. It's over, meaning that's it, it's yours and nobody else's, subhanAllah. So, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. They say that it's, we're making a noise outside. I think we should decrease the volume outside, inshallah. And I'll be speaking for a few more minutes and then I'll close. Do you know how long I've spoken for? What do you think? Those who haven't looked at the clock, yeah? If you haven't looked at the clock, tell me. I've spoken for 55 minutes, mashallah. 5 minutes remaining, inshallah. Supposed to speak for an hour, but it's okay. So, subhanAllah, my brothers and sisters, let's get back to the point. You know, we don't need to show, boast, and brag about all the things that we have because it can create jealousy and hatred amongst us. It can create jealousy and hatred from the people who are unsuspecting. We didn't even mean that. But this is why we say you don't have to boast and brag and show off. I learned this from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, from Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, the advice that his father gave him. Don't relate it to your brothers because you know what? They might become jealous of you. Guess what? They did. They did become jealous of him because he related it to them. Sometimes we don't listen to advice. You see, your dad tells you don't do this and you say, okay, and then you go and do it. And when you go and do it, you pay the price. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and grant us ease. So this evening, what I try to do here is to draw lessons from some of the stories of Adam alayhi salatu wa salam coming down. I wanted to actually go into a little bit more, but you know, I just let it flow as it flowed. And I thought perhaps I'd stop when the hour passes. So I'm sure we can take home quite a bit of this, inshallah. We learn to soften ourselves for the sake of Allah. I end with the same piece of advice I gave right at the beginning. My brothers and sisters, the best from amongst us is he or she who's actually the most conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So please become as conscious as you can of the Almighty. Work hard and strive towards worshipping the Almighty alone in a manner that will please Him. When you fulfill your salah, do so willingly. You know, people say, I'm reading salah because I have to. Try and get to a stage where you're reading it because you want to and see your life change. I love Allah because He's given me everything I have. And concentrate on the things you have, not on what you don't have. What you don't have is very small compared to what you do have. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who are grateful. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us again inshallah in Melbourne. And we ask Him to gather us again in Jannah to Firdaus. Mashallah, mashallah. My brothers and sisters, it's been awesome. It's been very, very hot here, but I didn't really feel the heat much because everyone's face has been like an air conditioner. You know what? They asked me, do you want a fan? I said, well, I think there are about 2,000 fans here, so it's okay. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give us. That was just a joke, anyway. Jazakumullah khair, aqulu qawli hadha, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barakatuh, wa sallam alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.